Start shortly,
and we're just waiting for a few more people to join in. Probably in next 5 minutes we will start. And thank you for the join. I can see Rohit, Satraj, and Suf Sanjit. Thank you for joining. Your efforts on this Sunday afternoon to attend our session here. So I will just start with the today's topic. This topic is impact of new education policy on startup ecosystem. So I myself, Shatadru Chaudhary, I'm the founder and director of Vadhan Education and Innovation Labs. With me, I'm having someone very special who is not just only the professor in NIT Srinagar. He's also one of our mentors. When I remember when Vanaha started in 2018, we approached him that we want to, we have some amazing products. We have some amazing curriculum for the students. And do you really think that it can be helpful? So it's not like every individual would like to give the newbies. We are very new on that time. People not know much about us. What professor has trusted is on our content. He was ready to give us platform, but only one condition was there, that it should be beneficial for their students. And that's the journey Vanaha was started. I mean, being an edtech startup, we started from there, started from NIT Srinagar, although we are locating in Kolkata. So I'm always very thankful to Professor Sat Purves. He is also heading the IIED Center at NIT Srinagar and responsible for the, you know, for their college to make sure the startup ecosystem goes well there. He's also one of those policymakers work with the government changes in the education policy. The government has decided to create some new startup norms, because today when we are talking about the employment, where the entire country is looking for the job, we are talking about job creators. We are not talking about job seekers. So this is the change we want to talk about here. Like those people have joined, I personally believe that you have so much interest that you want to do something out of the box. And government has come up with a new policy in just few months back. So what is this policy all about? So I will try to cover up those things. What are the new policy? How is going to get impact on you? How this thing going to impact when you will be, you know, covering up into the next year or next or after that when you will be graduating? How that will be helping to you, or how that will be a challenge for you, and how you should prepare, and if you want to start up, what are the things you should do, keep in your mind? So I will try to speak on that. And professor will be speaking on the policy, what has been designed for the startups, what is the things that, how they are planning to drive the innovation into different colleges through this system. We are having some students from Srinagar, we have some students from Assam, I can see, and some students are from different places. So probably it's a country-wise or the nation-wide people who are attending this session today, and probably some few more people will be joining us into the next couple of minutes. So let's start with that. Let's start with the session, and eventually people can join in. So what you can do is you can see there is a chat option, right? You can see the chat option. Whenever there is a query, you can ask. We will try to answer all of your queries, as well as what we will be keeping in, you know, some 15 to 20 minutes or around 30 minutes Q&A sessions. So on that time, we can have a interaction. So let's start the session. So I would like to welcome Professor Sat Purves here, who has agreed to join, to join our session, to have a talk with me, to have a talk with you people from his busy schedule. So thank you so much, Professor, for joining today's session and agreeing to help the students to understand what is the impact of new education policy on startup ecosystem or an individual being. So let's see. So I will start with this little bit. I don't want to go to, you know, a very, what I can say, very theoretical approach. I don't like to take. I will just talk about a little bit of myself. I am an engineer, entrepreneur, and educationist. I started my entrepreneurial journey in 2018. And the thing was, what motivates me, what drives me, that I wanted to solve a problem. I don't wanted to put my efforts to something which is ultimately just giving me money, not the satisfaction at the end of the day. So when I was in my college days, I was looking forward to do something different. I personally believe that, okay, this system, whatever is there, it's fine. It can help me to get marks. But the thing was, understand this, I am getting marks from my class 1, class 2, class 3 to 12, then JEE score. Then after that, engineering marks, engineering points. I have got enough of it. But what I wanted to do is, like, I love to call myself a doer. I wanted to do rather just mugging up and writing in the exam and getting some number. I wanted to solve some real-time problems. So on that time, when we were graduating, on that time, there was a very least possibilities that you can go and do something out of the box. But isn't there people are doing? Yes, people were still doing on that time. But government policies or the education policies was not so flexible. On that time, if you remember this movie, I think all of us have seen that. In this movie, this thing was actually my favorite. When he was talking about, he was just writing these two names and telling the class, the entire class, including the professors, that can you explain what is the meaning of these two words? And they all just started, you know, seeing the books that where exactly. And then suddenly they came up with, like, okay, we don't know, and you tell me. So they are like, okay, this is just a name of my friends. But it's important. It's not important that you are into the rat race. It's important that you are thinking that, okay, this is something is going to helpful for me, or this is something I'm going to learn from this session. Like here, you people are doing, here in this webinar. If I ask you that, why you are in this webinar? Many of the people, I'm telling you very honestly, many of the people will say, sir, I want a certificate. That happens. People join these webinars, people join different courses, people join different seminars just to get certificates. And very few are actually think of learning. And not only the webinars. With my experience visiting more than 500 colleges across India, and meeting over 10 to 15,000 students, what I find out, people are confused, especially the students who are studying engineering. They are totally clueless that why they are even studying it. And you know what? From there, I got this. Why are you studying civil engineer? I mean, why are you studying engineering? I'm a civil engineer, by the way. That's why the civil engineering came in my mind. Why are you studying engineering? This is a common question I ask to everyone. Why are you studying engineering? You know, what is the most common answer I get? I get this. I want to get a degree or certificate. The thing was, when you were towards the certificate, the numbers are very, very, very horrible. Like in India, there are every year some around 16 lakh students graduate with certificates. 16 lakh students go with the certificate, and 94% are actually not getting job. 94% are not getting job. More than 72% are actually switching their stream from engineering to something else. That means probably they were never meant for engineering. If I talk in this way, people, like students like us, what they do, they first complete their engineering, then do MBA, and then probably write a book, Three Mistakes of My Life. That happens. I'm telling you very honestly, that happens. People do IIT, IIM, and then writing a book. And they just think this is something I want to say. If you want to write a book, why don't you write a book at the first place? Why you want to spend a huge amount of money and time and efforts for the 4N+2, 6 years? What do you want? So they are like, okay, I want to write the books, but first I want to get a degree. And then I don't want to use it anymore. You know, what is the use? Try to recall your memory. What is the use currently of your 10th mark sheet, apart from that showing your birth date? Is there any use of that 10th standard sheet book? No. Then on that time, you were just mugging up. I have to get a good number. And all these things was there. 90% of the engineering students, they study on the last night. They prepare for the exam and they just write it. Then what gets missing in this whole process is this. People were actually not focusing on learning. That was the biggest drawback of the current ongoing education system or education policy what we are having. This is the number. I don't know whether any of you are from civil engineering. I am a civil engineer, so I'm telling you a fact. Here in India, majority of the engineering graduates, civil engineering graduates, core graduates, not only civil engineering, the core graduates are being offered this salary. Average, this was the average, 8,000 rupees. Where an IT engineer gets only 19,000 to 25,000 per month. That is also too low. Now, if I come to this, in a construction site, a mason's daily wage is 500 rupees per day, which takes approximately 15,000 rupees. Now, my question is, the people who are studying in the private colleges, there are more than 2,000, 3,000, 3,000 almost private colleges, engineering colleges are there. Now, they are spending lakhs of rupees to get what? This? That's not correct. And if I ask you here, you all are students probably. I can see here almost 20 people have joined us right now. You all are student. If I tell you, boss, I am having a job for you. Will you take up? I'm running a startup, right? If I ask you, hey, come on, join me. But what I will be not doing is I will not tell you what, I mean, I am not going to spend my time on you. I want you to do the work for me. Will you be able to do that? Probably no. You'll be saying, sir, at least some guidance I'll be needing for some months because I am a fresher. Now, companies has to spend a huge amount of money on the skill development. I'm giving you an example. We recruited a fresher because like we are having a construction company, let's say. We recruited a fresher. Now, this fresher, I thought, okay, he doesn't have the knowledge of practical things, but he's very good at theory because there is no question about it. But I cannot do with the theory part, right? I need to know the practical things. Because I want to recruit someone because they have to be on my money. They have to participate actively on my money-making process. Now, the thing was, when I recruited and for 6 months, I trained that fellow on the practical skills. Now, when I trained that fellow for the 6 months in the practical skills, what happened? His theoretical knowledge was good. Now he's practically doing well as well. But in this 6 months, when I was training them, I used to pay the salary. But 4 years, when they were studying or they're skilling up, on that time, they used to pay the money to the colleges. Now, after the 6 months, what happened? They become good at practical. They got experience. They are as well as good at the theory part as well. Now they are demanding, sir, I want more salary. Now I am a startup. I cannot give you more than, let's say, 25,000. Now they say, I want to switch. This is very obvious. You should switch. I am telling you, you must switch. But the thing was, when I am spending my 6 months of time, efforts, money, and then when I need you, on that time you are not there. So why should I recruit a fresher? That's the biggest problem is coming up. That's the biggest problem currently in the industry is facing. Today you are seeing hundreds, thousand videos of mockery or memes, or there are troll videos on engineering. Engineering has down to in that level. Previously engineering was a big thing, but today some extent we all are responsible for making it down. Currently, if I show you a number, this is the current students in India. 70 million plus students. Millions in the global perspective, let's say. Now, here, what we see in India, max students are here are textbook geniuses. They don't have the practical expertise which is required for the industry. Consequences, lack of skill and confidence. Those people, like, I will tell you, one of my students recently, there was a student of mine. I told him, see, there is a work opportunity is there. Would you like to take up? That fellow is graduated. So he was a little bit worried. He's saying, sir, I never walked it. I learned it. That's fine. But I am not confident enough. That means after 4 years of doing of engineering, if you are not confident enough, that means there is a problem. There is a problem in the system. Here is also the same thing. I'm just telling you, in earlier, if you some people, you know the how robots has taken the markets. Previously, this question was like, oh, this is not possible. Like, can robots write a symphony? Can robots turn a beautiful canvas into a beautiful masterpiece? Previously, the answer was no, but then you can see here, Chris Wilson, this fellow has created a symphony from this robotic system. Can robot turn a canvas into a beautiful masterpiece? Yes, this has been done as well. Now the question comes to you, can robots replace you in the down the line for next 10, 15 years? Are you ready for it? Let's say you are graduating this year or next year or 2022, you are graduating. Are you ready to fight with this system in the 10 years down the line? And I am telling you from the industry perspective, every 10, 15 years, there will be a recession like this. And all the effects will get to the mid-range employees. Because mid-range employees, no one wants to have them because they get used to with the system. They are a little bit uncontrollable. They ask for more money. Today, you India have seen 1.89 crore job loss. 1.89 crore job loss. Out of that, 95% almost are the mid-range employees, not the senior executive, neither the entry-level people. Next 10 to 15 years down the line, you will be in the situation where you have a 10 years of experience. Now, do you really think, do you have the real capabilities or the development skills or the mindset, most importantly, the mindset to compete with them? And new education policy is going to affect you. Now, how? Let me just take you to this. First problem or the final problem, the last thing I will talk about the problems. Here, in our current education system, what is missing? We are not preparing our students for the value creation. We are not, some extent, I don't know what's problem with us. We never talk about how to earn money. We never teach students two important things, how to earn money, how to manage money. At your age, this is the time when you should think of money, how to make money, how to grow money, how to invest your money in the right direction. I personally never appeared for MBA. I thought of, instead of what I did was, I did a starter because of one reason. When I had the understanding of the money, I realized instead of spending, I don't want to buy degree. Instead of spending my time on an MBA college, I want to work for a startup to understand the work practically. That was my intention. Because what MBA will teach me, a theoretical concept, what startup will teach me, the practical work, I will be in the real-time situation. Now I joined the startup because startup will give you the exposure, end-to-end exposure, because they don't have people to work. They will give you all the works to do. So I understand how to take responsibility, how to owning a department. Now the fun thing is there's always one thing in always in my mind, that's the money. If I do MBA, I have to spend around, let's say 10, 15 lakhs. But if I do a startup, then that money will be coming to in my pocket in terms of salary. Today, technology is into the next level. People are earning money from making YouTube videos, creating contents, and there are different sources. They are not skilled enough. They are not technically blessed enough as well. But you are. Don't you think you have the enough skills to earn money? There are a few ways. This is these things. We probably don't talk much. How to start up, how to do freelancing, how to do knowledge sharing, how to get licenses to earn money. I am so happy that institution like NIT Srinagar, today they are focusing on this. They are focusing on this most important term that is called value creation. Each of you, just think of it, each of you, if you start up, you are the brightest mind of our country. I can't see yourself seeking a job. I can see you are the creator of a job. Job creator. With your innovation, with your idea. Because then only you can compete and manage the next workforce till 20, let's say 10, 15 years down the line. They are saying, by 10 years down the line, almost 80% of the workforce will be taken over by these robots or AI, artificial intelligence. But what they are not saying is 20% of the people will be controlling those 80% robot and AI system. And that will be controlled by the HI, which is human intelligence. And why can't it be your intelligence? Government, with this new education policy, working on that. Although there are drawbacks, there are controversy, I'm not going there. But this is one of those breakthroughs what happened here. If I come to this evolution of education policy, I found it a big circle. It's a circular journey. It's a loop has been created. Where we started, we are ending up here. I'll just show you how the evolution with the quick slides. This was our earlier education system, right? Ancient education system. We call it Guru Shishwa Parampara. We had Takshila, we have Ujjain, we have Bikramshila, we have Nalanda, one of the finest universities in the world we are having here. We had great mathematician, metaphysicist. We have all these bright minds of the world in this region. But again, we somehow adopted to Western cultures because of the colonial system. In 1830 to 1950, the Lord Thomas Babington Macaulay, in 1830, he has introduced the education system, which actually meant to create the workers for the Britishers. If I'm a Bengali, and let's say if you are speaking Hindi, the word is Nokri, right? In Bengali, it's Chakri. In Assamese, also the same probably. Nokri, the word comes from Nokar. This system makes you for that. And because they wanted this. And you know, in your class, in lots of schools, I remember my schools, there was a siren. Lunch break siren, 1 hour happened siren, 2 hours happened siren, 3 hour happened siren. This all used to happen into this, you know, jute companies in this region. Those companies used to have those siren system, and the students were meant to prepare for that. Again, if I take all this thing apart, look at in this way, they were working the people, making the people with their education system to create their workforce. They are preparing them for the workforce. I mean, for the work what they need. Ultimately, that they will be helping into their industry. That was the main focus. In 1952, the post era, the CBSE has been formed. But although we were still in the hangover of this education system, we are still typically following it. If I talk about this journey from 1940, I mean post-independent, 1948 and 49, the University of Education Commission, UEC, was formed, then Secondary Education Committee, then Education Commission under the Dr. S. Kothari, then 1968, the first national policy for, this is called National Education Policy, NEP, has been formed in 1968 under the Indira Gandhi government. Then 1972, 42nd constitutional amendment was done. Then 1986, again Rajiv Gandhi brought that NEP. Then in 1992, then 2016 and 2019. This was the journey. This was the roadmap. But before this, up to 2014, before the 2014, there was no major breakthrough. There's no major breakthrough. They were just modifying. For some reason, they were modifying the school systems. But that was not helpful. That was not helpful because you cannot have this 1830s model in the year of 2020 or 20s or let's say 1900. You cannot have the same decision for 100, 200 years long, right? Your policies has changed. Things has been changed. And in this whole process, if I go to our Vedic system, you know what was there? In Gurukul, whatever you wanted to learn, you get to learn from there. We have all read probably the Mahabharata. Bhim was for some something he can operate. Arjuna was something for. Different people have a different their powers which they have grown. It's not like everyone sitting into the same class and mugging up the same mathematics or history or arts. We all are individuals. We probably want to do good at art. Some of my friend might be good at something else. But that was not something. Here, the judgment was based on the schedule parameters. That was not exploring the individuality or the skills or the focusing on individuality. Now, this has been the work of these people. When Europe gave us this, on the by time, Europe also have taken our cultures. They were focusing on skill development, individual skill development. And see, this is not new. We say we have taken it from other countries. This is from our country only. They adopted, and we are seeing them, Western people are doing this. This is something good. Right? This was from your country only. It's not like downloaded from anywhere. In the year 2002, there was another breakthrough, that is the right to education. But again, right to education was not a huge change into the education policy. But this was a good move in the year 2002. But with this 2014 and 2016, this is the period was very significant to understand the new education policy. 2014, when the new government came in, they were very enthusiastic about changing the education system. They were seriously, it was been there for a long period of time that they want to change it. They want to help the youth because they are also seeing, they are the good people. They are seeing the country, how they are going into the, very horrific figures. The unemployment figures today. And that the academians or the academy cannot say no to that because there was some problem. So together, there was a hand-holding should be there and that has to change. So government was very, very conscious about that. So what they do was they form a new committee under the TSR Subramaniam, which objective was improve the quality education, credibility education, addressing of the gap of the implementation. They submitted a report on 2016, but somehow that report was not, I don't know what happened, but that was not there. But further, in 2019, under the Dr. K. Kasturi Rangan, they form a new panel which is responsible for the 2020 this education policy. What is the three major changes they have focused here? This is something important. One, earlier, which was to be the HRD ministry, is now renamed as the Ministry of Education. GDP has improved. I mean, earlier they said that they used to give 1.6% of the GDP, and right now they are giving 6%. They are planning to give. Focus on the gross enrollment ratio, which will be increased to 50% by 2035. Now, I will simplify this, what exactly it is all about. So earlier, understand this, and if you understand this, then only then you can understand how it will be impacting the ecosystem. See, earlier it was they do not consider at this stage, which is called the foundational stage or the pre-learning. This time they have break it into 3+2. I mean, although they have ICDS, they have Anganwari, they have free schooling from a long period. But they don't used to consider them as a proper way of, I mean, they don't used to value it. But right now they decided that multi-level plan and activity-based learning, this is very important. Private college to, if you see your friends from the private schools, they are already learning that. Now government is adopting that. That will be the good thing, that most of the schools, government schools, and the most of the youth, most of the young kids will have the access to the activity-based learning, which currently limited to the people who have a lot of money and can spend 1 lakh rupees per year to some of the preschools. And you know some of the, what are the, in the big name preschools are. Then there will be a preparatory stage where play, discovery, and activity based on the interactive class learning. Then the middle age, where experimental learning in the sciences, mathematics, arts, social science, humanities. You won't believe, private course schools already have taken this. Vanaha has different courses on robotics, coding, and on the one hand, we are teaching it to the engineering students. On the other hand, we are also teaching this same thing to the school students of fourth, fifth standard in DPS. That means earlier, it was the DPS students who knew the coding. And right, the mass of the students will be knowing it. But I don't know how many of you know coding, and if you are from a core background, it's fine. If you are not, then there will be a problem. Then the secondary is a multidisciplinary study, critical thinking, creative thinking. Because I was going through an article yesterday before, where Steve Wozniak was saying, India, some extent, lack the creativity. And what they are focusing on here is this. What are the three major changes? Learn coding from the sixth standard. This, they are saying that we are inspired from China, because China, how they have developed with the industry and innovation, we want to add this. Second thing, mother tongue to be medium till the fifth standard, inspired from the European nations. Report cards, which is earlier it used to be, you know, that it has to be how much marks you have got. Right now, it will be based on the skills and capabilities. Because I used to believe that. Don't you think Sachin Tendulkar even got out in a certain date on a zero run? If Sachin can out at zero run, then don't you think that one particular day in a 365 days you are appearing for that exam? Don't you think that can be your bad day and you cannot perform? There are many of time I have seen so many good students, bright students. They write JEE, they write government exams. And because they were not so confident enough, they are a little bit nervous or they don't feel good. Maybe there is a problem in their health issues. For one particular day, if they write a bad exam, that will be there for the entire life. If I get my 10th standard, if I got 35 mark in some paper, that will be remain with me for the next 100 years until I die. But don't you think that one particular day I can have a bad day as well? So that they are planning to change. In the higher education, they are planning to have a single regulator for the higher education that accepts the medical and legal, flexible curriculums, vocational subjects, interdisciplinary combination of subjects. Sanskrit will be offered to any level along with the classical language. Academics or bank records, multiple exit and entry, no more MPhil. Now, this is the 2 point, academic bank of credit and multiple exit and entry. This has a very significant thing in here, in this education policy. What is that? As well as the interdisciplinary combination of subject. I have so many friends who are good at art and who is good at science as well. They love to do math and they also want to do some of the art stuff, but they cannot work with that. They cannot work with it because there's no combination. Today, there will be you can take whatever the combination you want. So that means a growing opportunity is there. Second thing, Academic Bank of Credit. I'm telling you a figure. India currently seeing 10,000 engineering colleges. In the prospect of engineering, I'm talking about. So many students have dropped out. So many students today have dropped out because they cannot pay the fees to the colleges. Okay. Now what happens when they dropped out? They have to again start from the first year. So that means their money, their effort is been waste. There are many entrepreneurs I know, you know what happened to them? They dropped out. Some of them didn't even started their studying or after they didn't do their college because of one thing. They were like, my financial condition is not good. If I spend that money for 4 years, if I don't continue till 4 year, then what will happen? My money will be wasted and I will be not having a degree. Government comes up with this thing that called Academic Bank of Credits, which will be this. First year, if you finish, and let's say you want to take a break, okay, then you will be getting a certificate. If you finish 2 years, you will get advanced diploma. 3 years, bachelor degree. 4 years, bachelor degree with research. Anytime in this between, if you are dropping out, you can start exactly from here. You don't have to start over. First year, second year, you completed, you dropped. You can start from the third. That is called multiple exit and entry. And that will be controlled. How much credit you have got in the last semester will be controlled by your Academic Bank of Credits. It's an amazing thing. It's an amazing thing which they have done. And that's a flexible curriculums. Major changes in the higher education. One more thing is they introduced something called MERU, Multidisciplinary Education and Research Universities. This will be earlier, it used to be BTech will be having a 4 years, right? BTech having a 4 years, Rohit, like I can see your question. BTech is having a 4 year, but the thing was like there are lots of students who used to be dropped out in between, right? Like let's say someone dropped out at the first year, someone dropped out at the second year, someone dropped out at the third year. Then they have to start over, but this time that not. You can just take up. More importantly, they are focusing on the innovation. So that is here. Earlier, that used to be the government used to have controlled by different bodies. Right now, there will be a one simple thing, which is MERU, Multidisciplinary Education and Research University. That will be coming for all the IITs, NITs, they will be coming under this. On the other hand, they have NRF, National Research Foundation, to promote research on the higher education. Now, here is some important fact I'm telling you. What was missing into the our current education system? As per the data, in the year 2008, we have spent some around 0.8% of our GDP on research. R&D, 0.8, and 2019, as per the data of 2019, we have spent only 0.06%, 2008, 0.8%, 2019, it is 0.06% of the GDP which we have spent on our R&D. Today, government has coming up with vocal for local, Atmanirbhar. You all have heard these words. But to do this, you need your research and innovation. India today is banning Chinese product. Very good. Now, what is the alternative? India doesn't manufacture plastic. They don't. I mean, India cannot just, you know, use the plastic in a proper way. So for that, you need innovation. You need R&D. You need the students to focus on the more innovative works. On the very, very initial stage. This is a right opportunity where the entire world is hating China and India is a big market as well. They want to come in. But do you have the workforce ready? They can't just take people from outside. They wanted to do the business in this region. If you are not ready, then it will go to Vietnam. Or it will go to Taiwan. But remember, Vietnam and Taiwan is not a market. Here, all the companies want to start because and why we are startup. India's policy is very good for the businesses. And India is probably, I don't know whether it's a good or bad, India is the only country which allows monopoly. So all the big companies want to come into the India and do market. And they need the good people to control the entire crowd. And they want to create the product on India-based products. The students should have the understanding of that. And for that, they have made it into controlled by the MERU. They have created NRF. They are creating the introduction of the HECI, which is the Higher Education Commission of India. Only thing they will be not controlling is the medical and legal. Their one point focus is the innovation. They are bringing change. Now the big, now what will be the problem? I told you all the positive things here, but the execution can be a big deal here. Execution can be a big deal here, because who will be controlling? Who will be teaching? Who will be teaching here? So they plan, like, they will be having the NCFTE, which is National Curriculum Framework for the Teacher Education for 2021. By 2030, the minimum degree for qualification will be 4 years of integrated BEd. But I don't know how, whether it will be helping the practical things and how. That is, schools, colleges, they have to decide on the innovation. The most important thing, now coming to the startup, there, with these startups, two things here will be helpful. When there will be more R&D, because you are planning 6%, and you never been to 3%, more than India never exit 3% of the GDP on education, never. So if you plan on more R&D, that means more products will get developed, more skilled people will be coming in. Today, companies like us, they are spending a huge amount of money on the skill development. That will be, that can be stopped, and we can direct recruit the people whom I want, the best. More importantly, we will get the passionate recruitment. I will not get someone who wants job. I will be getting people who are actually interested in. And when the more R&D will happen, that will drive our innovations directly. What startups need? Every startups who wants to succeed, they want innovation. They want innovative people. They want creative minds. Earlier, the creativity was not have no places in that place in this system. It used to be you learn the concept, you write it, you get the marks. If you don't write it, that will be not there. Right now, innovation also will be considered. And finally, industry-oriented learning will help the reduce the skill gap and the future expenses on skilling or the skill development. So these are the way. I am hopeful that India will be producing some amount of engineers, some amount of innovators, some amount of entrepreneurs in the coming days. As well, you people, why I've shared all this data with you. Now, I am hopeful you can understand those students will be going through this. Let's say a student currently in fifth standard. In the next 10 years when you will be working, that fellow will be in the market. I don't want you to be the old Nokia phone. You know how Nokia has been, you know, simply disappeared from the market. How Internet Explorer has been disappeared. How Yahoo has been disappeared. There will be continuous changes. There is a continuous innovation, skill development, and whatnot. Ecosystem, the startup ecosystem. We are the part of Bengal Chamber of Commerce, which is the oldest one, 1833. My company is listed to that, as well as NASSCOM. What we are seeing currently in all the startups, all the businesses, they don't care about your degree. Even we are not. We have people who doesn't have degree as well. We have one of my students, you won't believe, they are earning right from their second year. Some of them have started their startup right from their second year. And all these things possible when we go back to, if I just go back to with this education policy, whatever they have suggested, that okay, you can take multidisciplinary this, you can take yours planning, but have you thought like how a 12th standard student will decide what they should take, which engineering course they should take, what they like, what not? They need something. We need to go back to this thing, which is our old ancient education system, because you need a counselor, you need a mentor, you need a guide. So today, if you are starting up, you need this, and later you can use the currency of relationship. more networking, more the mentors network. You can get the friends network. You can use that network to build an amazing product. But what you need to do all these things, to put every effort successful in this policy, you need to have this mentor, which they don't never talked about. Even Vanaha, just in 2 years, we have been to almost 9 countries right now. These all people who was helping us, I don't think without them, we could have done anything. We got our mentors who are helping us. What decided to, okay, they are not charging anything. They are just very, what I can say, they are very happy to help and guide to us. As a student, now I always think that why I didn't get these people on my earlier stage during my college days. My life would have been simple. I would have known what I want. There need to be some psychometric test, like what I want. Sometimes we also don't know what we want. Many students call me. I do help lots of startups. They call me like, sir, what do you, how I can get your mentor? I want to do something. I want to start up, but I'm not getting the idea. Then we have to do some test and we tell, okay, this is something, is your passion. People are confused as well. So all these things, all this new education policy will be needing the counselors, will be needing the mentors, and you people should think of that. So anyways, while I'm talking about the innovation in the startup ecosystem, now I will be asking Mr. Sat Parvez, who's been working on this policy making, who's been helping the students all over the, I mean, Srinagar, as well as all over the nationwide students who are there in Srinagar to build startups. Now I want to know from him how he thinks this education policy, which we have discussed, which right now I have shared with you, will be impacting the startup ecosystem. What are the policies has been changed? And what are the things to be added in? What our students or the young people who's attending this session, or some of them I can see, some of the names I can see here, they all are doing or planning startups. How they can be or prepared for this? So I would like to introduce the professor from NIT Srinagar, the head from IIED Center at NIT Srinagar, Mr. Sat Parvez. Sir, can you just help us to understand?
Thank you so much, Mr. Satadru. It was a wonderful picture you gave to the students of the new policy and then how exactly it's going to help them in the future. And that's the future of India, basically. You know, if you are, if you see that, if India has to evolve as a 5 trillion economy, which we're aiming for, we have to evolve as a global innovation hub. That's very, very important. Now, if we have to evolve as a global innovation hub, that means we have to create thousands of islands of and ecosystems in the country which are self-sufficient and competitive. And they are working on great ideas. So the ideas means many things to many people. The ideas basically mean a new product. It means a new service. It means a new way of doing things. It means a new education policy. It means how exactly you put down the things for the students, where the students' creativity is enhanced, where they're able to, you know, make money, as you rightly said, and then they are able to create economic units. So basically, you know, our education institutions, I think they can be the best places, especially if you look at our higher education institutions, HEIs we call them, for achieving these objectives. Now these institutions need to emerge as the island of research and innovations. They need to emerge as an island of research and innovations. Otherwise, you know, the dream which we are looking ahead, the dream of a 5 trillion economy would not be met effectively until and unless the curriculum, the pedagogy, the attitude of the students, the thinkings, the thought process of the students, as well as the faculty members, as well as the mentors in and around, they have to get involved, they have to get changed, and a bunch of research and innovations is very, very important. A creativity enhancement has to be done, because I personally believe that everyone who is born with some degree of intelligence, some degree of creativity, but it's our system, the education system, which slowly and slowly, you know, kills the creativity. And now the new education policy which has come up, really there is a scope which is being seen that this new education policy will enhance the creative thinking of students, the creative thinking of people who are going to take this economy forward. Now, for this reason, what I would say that the national innovation policy is very, very crucial, and it must ensure that good ideas are pursued at startups and enterprises, and they contribute towards the wealth creation of the country. As you rightly said, sir, that you know, it's the research which is very, very important, and research, the GDP, as you said, it is hardly 0.08%, and in 2016 it was about 0.8%. Am I right? Those are the figures which you quoted, Mr. Satadru?
Yes.
Yeah. So you see, basically, if you look at the word research, what is research basically? Research is nothing but it's a conversion of wealth into knowledge. You're putting wealth, you're increasing the GDP, you're pumping in money, and then it gets converted into knowledge. Now, the question is, what is the credibility of the research which we are doing? How much do we have a system in India, in our universities, which actually measures that how much wealth has been put into the system and how much knowledge has been created as outputs? So that's very important.
Yes.
But if you look at innovations, you know, innovations is the conversion of knowledge into wealth. It's the conversion of knowledge into wealth. So that's why we need to innovate. We need to come up with new innovative ideas, new, you know, policies which can push innovations, not only in the schools, in institutions, in higher education systems, but also in enterprises, in companies, in our industries. You know, innovations have to be pushed forward, and they have to be in and around for 24/7. The people are, you know, creative, and they're coming up with new solutions. They are solving the problems by using innovations, and then that is how exactly the economy will grow, the country will grow. Now, entrepreneurship is very, very important. Out of all this, you know, as I said, the research is conversion of wealth into knowledge, whereas innovation is the conversion of knowledge into wealth. Now, where does this word and entrepreneurship comes in? This is one of the basic backbones of an economy. If we have more and more entrepreneurs, if you have more and more people who are the job givers instead of job seekers, then things will start moving. You know, the economy is building. And now entrepreneurship is basically, it's a global phenomena, and the growing population, jobs are decreasing, people have to accommodate it, and you know, people have to earn, they have to live, they have to strive. So entrepreneurship is very, very important. Entrepreneurship is an important component of augmenting the economy by creating economic units and centers. Now, they are nothing but they are the economic drivers. You know, we have to create more and more entrepreneurs. More and more people have to come and take up their own startups and their own, you know, ways of creating wealth, creating economy, creating employment for the people, for the drawdown. They have to help, you know, people, especially the students, you know, the student community, 25 are with them. They are the people who have to strive, who have to think out of the box, come out of that, you know, job seeking mentality, and then, you know, just seek jobs, common jobs, and stand in queues, fill up forms, and then wait, give interviews, wait for the results to come. And then, you know, you can imagine today's, I was told a few days back that Indian Railways, you know, there were some jobs which were advertised, and there were about 8 lakhs people who filled up the forms for only some 1,000 jobs. And out of them, they were PhDs. They were highly qualified people who don't have jobs. So this mentality has to be changed. You know, the mentality need to be changed. And it's the high time, the new policy which is coming. It's basically meant to change that job seeking mentality and then come up with, you know, job giving mentality that, okay, I will create wealth. I will create jobs and let others who are at the lower positions, let them come and join my endeavor, my company, my startup, and then you push him. So it's basically, you know, when you talk about entrepreneurship, startups, it's not only the one P, which is profits, when everybody thinks about profits, but it's about two other P's. It's very, very important. The second P is the people, the empowerment of people. You are empowering people. You're providing sustenance for their families. You are sustaining them. That's the second important P. So profits, empowering the people. And the third P, as you grow, you say that it's the planet. You're serving the planet. You're doing something for the planet to become a better place to live. So it's that thing which you have to keep in your mind, that these three P's are really going to give benefits to yourself and to the society. So innovations have to be done. You have to come up with you know, the buzzwords, startup, innovations, you know, entrepreneurship. These are the buzzwords which are used nowadays. And slowly India, for the last decade, we are finding that so many things are happening in these areas. And, you know, the startup policy, which we are discussing, also has a lot of things for the students in their campuses, where to push innovations and startup and then come up with such beautiful schemes where the students are going to get benefit out of those things which I'm going to discuss very soon. So, you know, innovations basically, by definition, is nothing but the introduction of something new. Anything which is new to yourself, anything which is new for the people, anything which can solve some problem, you know, is innovation. Innovation really is a core reason for modern existence. I say, if we are existing today, if we want to exist tomorrow, you have to innovate. If you don't innovate, we'll die. If you don't innovate, if you just take a status quo, then we'll die. There won't be any progress. People will not grow. Jobs will not get created. And then slowly and slowly, if the graph goes down, there's going to be decay. There's going to be end of the world. But it's only the innovations which have been driving this world. You know, look at the 18th century, 17th century, 16th century, 21st century. Look at the graph, how it's going up. And why the graph is going up? Because we have innovations. The result of innovations, you know, has always, it's always to improve the humanity, the human race. From the society's perspective, if you look, the fundamental outputs of innovations are economic growth. They are increased well-being and communication. They are educational accessibility. They are economic sustainability and many other things which are very, very important. So I just want to put my presentation, sir. I want to put my presentation and just like to share something, you know. Are you able to see it?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So this is what I was talking. That's why innovations. Why exactly innovations are important. And if you look at the fundamental outcomes of innovations, you know, as I was telling, it's the economic growth. Now, technological innovation is basically considered to be as the major source of economic growth. So it's we're talking about more or less, you know, as engineers, as technological creators, the economic growth is important, you know, because if technology grows, the economic grows. Now, this economic growth basically it refers to the increase in the inflation-adjusted market value of the goods and services, as all of us know about that, which is produced by the economy over a period of time. So it's basically, we can say that it's a conventionally measured as the percent rate of increase in the real GDP. That's very, very important. We want to increase the GDP of a country. So this is how exactly the economic enhancement would be done if technological innovations are basically considered as one of the major source and research is converted into technological and enhancing capabilities. Now, if you ask me, what are the two ways, basically, what are the ways to increase the output of the economy? You see, you can say that number one is the increase in the number of inputs that go to productive process. And the number second would be to come up with new ways to get more output from the same number of inputs. That's what innovation means to you. The second point basically describes the essence of innovations. It's the essence of innovations. So the purpose of innovation is to come up with new ideas and technologies that increase productivity and generate greater output with the same input. That's why when we talk about innovations, when we talk about being creative, we mean to you that, okay, you come up with some new products, new technology, new services, new processes. So that will basically do what? That will increase the number of inputs. Come up with a new ways to get more output from the same number of inputs. It's very important. Then the second part is increased well-being and communication. So we know that, you know, if we innovate, we are going to serve humanity. Look at the innovations which happen in the medical field, how innovations are helping patients to cure, how innovations are helping people to live a better life. Look at what the world is presently trying to find a solution. A lot of innovations are happening to find the vaccine. How exactly a vaccine need to be developed to fight the COVID-19 virus, which has affected the whole globe, the whole humanity. It has brought us to our back foot, and then we are unable to do what exactly we are supposed to do. So, you know, this is how exactly if an organization comes up with a vaccine, this vaccine can really make us go back to our basics, which we have been doing. So that's how exactly innovation will increase the well-being of human race, of human community, not only Indians, but the whole world. Now, education accessibility, we talked about that, you know, Mr. Satadru did mention about it. Environment sustainability, we all know about that we need to sustain the environmental problems that we are facing. So innovations need to bring some good, you know, solutions to fight the environmental sustainability. And of course, reduction in sickness, poverty, and hunger, that's the basic aim. As I told you, if you are a startup, if you are an entrepreneur, so you will be the trendsetters for people who are trying to, you know, bring the people from poor background, give them jobs, give them food, and you will be the one who can, you know, reduce sicknesses, poverty, and hunger. Now, what exactly, Mr. Satadru was talking about the innovations and the future jobs. That's a very important point which he mentioned. The technological advancement and increased productivity, what does it mean to us? It means that major changes for career today have to be carried out. If you look at the world economy, you know, this world economy is growing and could be more than double in size into 2050. What the economy is today, it will be doubled. And that is due to the continuous technology-driven product improvements. We see that how exactly products are improving. He just give example of Nokia. Where is Nokia? It's nowhere. New products have come. new services have come. So that's the change which the dynamic nature of, you know, things which happen because of innovations. Now, if you look at there's a report given by the New World Economic Forum. It says that nearly 133 million new jobs may be created by 2021. I think this was the report given few years back. And it also says that 75 million jobs will be displaced by, as Mr. Satadru rightly said, they'll be displaced by AI, robotics, automations, and so forth, the IoT. So these are the new, you know, where people have to do a lot of work. They have to think that, you know, what can we do with the human resources? So it's actually what I personally feel that these new jobs, the jobs of the future, they're not going to displace the people, but they are going to employ them at some different places. Because human resources, I feel, is one of the most important resources of a country. But the development depends upon how exactly you are able to make use of your human resources. So, of course, we have to look at the jobs which we have been doing for years now. They will be displaced. There will be new jobs created. And who will get these jobs? The people with skills. The people with skills. If you have the right skill, if you have the right knowledge, if you have the right skill set, then only you can move ahead. You know, as far as AI is concerned, automation and robotics are concerned. So that's very important, the innovations and the future jobs. So, you know, generally speaking, the main purpose of innovation is to improve the lives of the people. When it comes to managing a business, innovation is a key for making any kind of progress. Small improvements eventually lead to bigger and better ideas that may one day become revolutionary. It's very important for you to learn that the revolutions are basically brought up with small improvements, small ideas. So even if small ideas come to you, don't think that it is small. It's just a meager idea. So it can bring a revolution. But however, you are responsible for finding ways to make improvement in your own sphere of influence. Now, that's very important. So every individual would not have the same skill sets. Every individual will not have the same creativity. Every individual will not have the same likes. So the spheres vary, the spheres influence. And that it's the people who have to decide what is my sphere. What is myself? What is the God-gifted talent present in me? What is my interest? Where exactly I want to go? Why I should take engineering if my friend is also taking engineering? You see, I remember I belong to this place in Jammu and Kashmir. A decade back, the only thing which was in the mind of the students was either go for medical or go for non-medical. There was no third thing. A couple of decades back, you know, when I was a student, so everybody used to say, "Aapne kya lena hai, medical or non-medical?" There was no, you know, third thing which existed. But now things have changed. People know that there are other things around. When the evolution has happened, the policies have changed. The internet has come. People know what is going around the world. So it's that the mindset has to be changed. The mindset which will force people to do a thing which is available, not based upon their talent, not based upon their creativity, not based upon their interest. So it's very, very important that the policy which we design takes care of all these things which develops with the interest of the people. That's very, very important. So I think the policy the highlights have already been given by Mr. Satadru. So these are some of the highlights which have been mentioned and how exactly it's going to help the students and the institutions, the schools and the colleges. If you look at this slide, it says that there's a figure which has been taken from 1977 to 2015 is the number of patents granted, not filed but granted. Why patents are important? Why patents are important? Because what I believe that it's the patent which are one of the indicators of the innovative health of a nation. How innovative a nation is, how innovative a country is. One of the indicators among many is patents granted to that nation. So from 1977 to 2015, there were about 58 or 57.5 lakh patents which were granted to the United States of America. And if you look at the India, it was meager, 17.8 thousand patents. This is very recently, 2015. Look at the small countries like South Korea, Taiwan, you know, the European countries. So they are in Japan is a very small country. So the patents granted during that period was about 10.69 thousand, which is very, very high. Now, the figures which I have got from the net explains that in year 2016, it's just 4 years back, US, there were 56.59 thousand patents, which were patent applications which were filed. And if you look at India, it was only 1,529 patents. And look at the other countries. So what does it mean? It means no, till 2016, 17, 18, the innovative health of India is very, very poor. We need to do something. We need to come up with a policy which can help students, which can help not only the students of the higher education, but students of the school to think differently, to behave differently, to learn differently, to exhibit differently. And that's the reason, that's the only reason what I would say that which would increase the number of patents filed or which would increase the number of patents granted. And this is the only way in which the health of the nation, as far as the innovation health of the nation is concerned, that will be improved. Excuse me. Now, the journey from creativity to entrepreneurship is a three-phase journey. The first step is creativity. The first step is creativity. How different you think, how new things you are thinking about, how you develop the ideas, how exactly the ideas are coming in you to solve the problem. And then, as I told you, that our education system, which we had in India, that was destroying creativity. Journalists believed that a student is, or a child, or a man is very creative from the age group of 8 to 11. So that's the, you know, 8, 9, 10, 11, he's very, very creative. But the education system which we were following, it's such that you have to mug up things, you have to score, you have to get good marks, whether it's the parents or the teachers or the student himself. We are forced to live in a, we are forced to study or be in a education system where scores matters. And this scores, you know, percentage, pointer, and so forth, you know, this kills our creativity. We don't want to be creative. We don't want to think out of box, because if we think out of box, our scores will come down. Our pointer will go down. This policy has been, you know, this lacuna has been very well addressed in today's the new education policy 2020. Similarly, the second step is innovations. Now, if you're creative, if you have some innovative idea, so what to do with an innovation? Where should you go? Whose doors are you going to knock? Who is going to help you to do something different? So doing new things is innovation. So I congratulate all of you that the new education policy 2020, which has come up, is addressing these problems. You know, where if you have something, if you have an innovation and you have a question in your mind, what to do with an innovation, so you have an answer to this question in your schools or in your colleges. And the third step is what is called as the entrepreneurship. Now, this is creating value in the marketplace. Now, if you have done your innovations, if incubation has been successfully done, you come up with a prototype. A prototype is ready. It's ready. Now, what to do with this prototype? Where should I go? Who will help me to get this product into the market? That's the next challenge which generally we face. And if you're a student, you cannot afford to do it because you will lose credits. You will lose pointers. People will tell you, oh, forget with the innovation. You will fail. You will fail badly. You will not get a job. You won't be recognized in the after your studies. So what you do? You leave your ideas. You leave your innovations. And then join the mainstream. The mainstream. Do what others do. That kills creativity. That kills innovations. So the new policy which has really come 2020 is really going to help you to become an entrepreneur. It's going to take your product to the marketplace. Your colleges, your institutions are really going to help you. And the value which you have created, that definitely will be pushed with ease to the market because the policy has things in place. So what I would say that the new education policy 2020 is really a commendable step by the government to achieve the objectives of providing not only the quality education, but also the skillful, talented, and professional youth population will be developed and will be really, they'll get help and benefit out of this policy. So the learning system, like online learning, which we are presently trying to undergo, the digital courses, they are also being encouraged in this policy. So this policy also lays emphasis on the learning and the preserving the traditional languages, skill development, innovations, and startups, self-reliance, as Mr. Satadru has already talked about. Now, this is very, very important part, which I want to, you know, the key entrepreneurial characteristics. Because until and unless you don't know about them, they are inherited in you. And if you are not aware of the key entrepreneurial characteristics, then even if something is given to you, you'll not appreciate it. Even if policy is there, but these characteristics, are you unaware of it or you are not motivated well to do things in the right perspective, then again, the policy is not going to put something in a glass of water and you just drink that water and you'll be an entrepreneur or a startup. No. The first important point as a key characteristic to become an entrepreneur is motivation. But I would say how passionate you are. So it's something which is inherited in you. You have to be passionate. You have to be an enterprising person. And only the enterprising person has, the enterprising person will be enterprising only when he's highly motivated, he's highly energetic. He has the capacity for hard work. So that's the first part, the first important key characteristics of an entrepreneur. The second important thing is a creative tendency. That's very important. If that tendency is missing, again, you lose something. So you have to create a creative tendency. The enterprising person, as an enterprising person, you have to be restless with ideas. If you're not restless, if you're satisfied with what you have, then this creative tendency will vanish. So the enterprising person is restless with ideas, has an imaginative approach. So you have to imagine a lot to solve problems. And you have to tend to see life in a different way, from a different perspective, from a different angle. That's what we call, you have to think out of box. So that's the creative tendency which has to be inculcated. And entrepreneurs cannot, you cannot become an entrepreneur until unless you are ready to take risks. So this is one of the reasons why most of the students, or most of the, you know, prospective entrepreneurs leave the track. They jump off the track and go to the mainstream because they are not in a position to take risks. There are a lot of inhibitions in their mind, the inhibitions of failure. So if I fail, what will do? So is this failure which is actually stopping you to take risks, to take calculated risks? So the enterprising person again is opportunist. You have to be opportunist. It's very, very important. And you have to seek information and expertise to evaluate it, if it is worth pursuing the opportunity, which will usually involve some risk. So nowadays you are living in the world where you have a lot of mentors, you have a lot of handholding. If you take a couple of decades back, the entrepreneurs, if you talk to some entrepreneur, he said it's my old capability. I had no mentors. There were no mentoring. There was no handholding. There was no incubation centers. So what I have done, by dint of my own hard work, by taking risks, I've involved myself, jumped into the fire, and then I came out with success. So that's very important. You have to have a risk-taking capability. It's very important. And the locus of control, is nothing but it's a psychological concept that basically refers to how strongly people believe they have control over the situation and experiences that affect their lives. So that is the locus of control which you should have. So as an enterprising person, you have an internal rather than external locus of control. So somebody within your heart, someone within your mind, someone, your own conscience has to come up. You have to believe, you have to start believing in yourself. You have to take control of yourself. Nobody will take control of you. So your destiny is in your hands and you are the master of your own luck. So that's very important. So if those four things are missing in your life, you cannot become a successful entrepreneur. You cannot become a successful startup. But I find Mr. Satadru Chaudhary, he has all these four things from his talk. You must appreciate that all these four things are present in him, and that's why it's making him a successful entrepreneur. So the National Innovation Startup Policy 2019 for students and faculty, this has just been rolled by the MHRD, still we call it MHRD, and now it is the Ministry of Education, which it will be renamed as. I'll just go very quickly to the main important highlights. This was launched by the Honorable Minister of Human Resources on 11th September 2019. The policy basically intends to guide, provide a guideline for the higher education institutions to promote students and faculty driven innovations and startups. Till now there was no promotion of students. You know, one of my students is also here. Shubham is here. Shubham, are you here? Shubham, are you here? Are you listening? Hello? Am I audible? Hello?
Hello? Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. I'm Shubham, sir.
Are you here?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Shubham is a student of NIT Srinagar and very enterprising, very, very innovative. He has come up with an innovation, a prototype of, green washing machine. You see, there's so much of water which is getting wasted in our kitchens. If you take the Indian kitchens, when you wash rice, grains, vegetables, and so forth, so you just put them under the tap, open the tap, and there's so much of water which is getting drained out, wasted. So he came up with a brilliant idea that let me design a machine. Now, a machine which in which you can put all this stuff at one end, put small bit of water from the other end, and then the contents will get washed clean, and then the water which is used will be purified and used as a drinking water. So this is the brilliant idea which he has. He has developed a prototype. But what I found, that he was always worried. He was worried about what to do with my innovation, what to do with my courses, what to do with my pointer, what to do with my degree. And now, you know, he's not focusing on this innovation. Now, this policy, students like Shubham and thousands of such students of different universities, for them, this policy is giving a promising reply to such problems. It's giving a promising solution to such problems. So it will be instrumental in leveraging the potential of students' problem solving and entrepreneurial mindset. So he has to develop an entrepreneurial mindset, is very important, and promoting a strong intra and inter-institutional partnership. Yes. Now, so this policy has, you know, a lot of beautiful things which the students and as well as the faculty members can enjoy. Look at the methods for innovation and startup policy implementation. The first talks about the strategic measures at the university and the institute level. So every institute has to formulate what we call as the institution's innovation and startup policy. So I'm sure that the universities you belong to, they must be coming up with their own innovation and startup policy. And at Srinagar, presently, we are designing our own innovation and startup policy, where we have a lot of beautiful things for students like Shubham, who can take a credit off, who can be given financial assistance, and who can be given IPR protection and IPR support. Whatever support he needs will be provided to him. And then there will be, you know, if he wants to take a semester break, there'll be a semester break. He'll be given credits on the type of innovation he has done. So he will earn credits also. So such beautiful things are really coming up. So basically, at the institute level, at the university level, we have to formulate such policies, taking into consideration the local ecosystems, and the local ecosystem has to be matched with the institutional ecosystem. The policy has to have international partnerships, including exchange programs with different institutions. That's very important. And now we can handhold not only with our professors, we can handhold with other professors of different universities. We can handhold with mentors around the world, because the policy is basically giving you support. A lot of support is being given to you to develop your ideas, to develop your innovations, to develop your prototypes, and to go to the market with your product. So the few other policies, the highlights of these policies, the creation of innovation fund. This is very important, which I want to talk. Now, the Ministry of Education is directing all the institutions that please, minimum of 1% of institution total budget has to be spent on innovations. So 1% is huge number, maybe to the tune of minimum of 10 lakhs. So if I have 9 to 10 lakh rupees for a 1 year, at least there will be a couple of two or three good innovations which I'll be supporting financially. And if you have a good finance backup and you have a good, you know, support system, I think the innovations will boom in institutions. As I told you, academic breaks for a semester, year to work on their startup on their individual startups, credits for working on in innovative prototypes. So people will be helping in developing your business models. And then you see the lot of problems which the current policy, the old policy had, that equity. Now, even IITs, they take a lot of equity from the students. The ministry is of the opinion that no, it's from 2% to 9.5% equity. Not more than 9.5% equity has to be given to the institutes. So this is a stake in startup or company by institutions incubator. So if you're taking incubation support, and if you're taking a lot of infrastructure of institutions, then tomorrow you start up with your own company, you start up with your own venture, and you are successful in that venture, you create wealth. So only 2 to 9.5% of equity has to be shared with your institute. So that's a very meager amount if you are doing well. So the complete ownership of IPR by the inventor in case of non-usage of institutional facilities, resources. Even if I remember, you know, in a few years back, there was a discussion in IIT Delhi that one of the students had used, has developed some startup of his own. The director called him and he told that whose will be the patent. The student's choice is mine patent because I have worked on this. The director told him, no, the patent has to be shared with the institute, institute, or the maximum part should go to the institute because you have been borrowing institute's resources. He told, no, I haven't borrowed any institute resources. The director told him, no, it's the institute's internet which you've used, and that is enough for you to give the patent to the institute or share the patent with the institute. So the student was very dejected. So this point was taken up by the ministry, and now the policy which they have, the new policy will say that complete ownership of IPR by the inventors will be go to students. But in case there some resources, a substantial amount of resources have been shared, then you will of course share it with the institute. The services to be offered by the institute in lieu of the equity fee-based or zero payment model. You see, even, you know, presently NIT is working on a zero payment model. We don't charge the startups. We don't charge the incubators. In case we find them some prospective, you know, services are being given, high-level services are being given, mentorship is being given, the payment would be very meager, not very high, because institutions have to survive. So for their survival, for the incubation centers to survive, some amount of money, which will be very meager, depending upon case-to-case studies, will be charged in lieu of equity. Now, I'll not go in detail of each and everything, but you know, the other points which are discussed here is that the higher education institution strategies and governance for promoting, this is one important area, which the complete report is, the guidelines are given, what are the strategies of individual institutions, and what are the governance systems. So we are trying to develop the strategies, we are trying to develop the governance systems, how exactly the governance will come up. And that then the next point is creating innovation pipeline and pathways for entrepreneurs. Now, what are the pipelines which you are creating? What are the innovation pipelines and the pathways for entrepreneurs? So like, we have to ensure that maximum students should participate and go through pre-incubation process of problem identification, solution development, proof of concept, validation, prototype development, business model, and proposal development. So this is very, very important. These are the pipelines where actually will lead to development of entrepreneurs. So we have a very clear and cut, crisp, defined policies as far as the pipelines are concerned. So similarly, like the institutions should link and collaborate their incubation center with the incubation units with external agencies. So it's basically, you know, the collaborations, the networking, which are important. So the policy defines some important points for this collaboration also. Then the next point talks about building organizational capacities, human resources, and incentivize. How exactly we are giving incentives, which I talked about, the incentives which are given to the students. Even the faculty can get a lot of incentives. They want to start up their own venture with the help of the students. They have the students have, the faculty has developed a technology and he wants to go ahead with establishing a venture out of the technology which he has developed. So the new policy is giving room to develop his own venture without sacrificing the normal routine classwork or the academic programs, but there is a lot of good things for the faculty as well as for the students, which is reflected in this policy. Then collaboration, co-creation, business relationships, and knowledge exchange. So a lot of things have to be put as far as this point is concerned. So the guidelines will tell us to manage the relationship with external stakeholders. The external stakeholders have to be brought in picture. So if Vanaha is an external stakeholder. We have to, you know, club them with institutions, and then they can help us, guide us based upon their own experience, and then, you know, help the students to formulate their problem, and then take their, you know, innovative ideas to the market. So such agencies have to be, you know, looped in such colleges and institutions. So we have to come up with the mechanisms which should be devised to ensure maximum exploitation of entrepreneurship opportunities with industry and commercial collaborations. So the industrial collaborations are also reflected in these policies. So knowledge development, which we develop in the institutions through development of innovations, knowledge platform using ICT capabilities, repositories of ideas, POCs, innovations and startups can be managed through such platforms. These are some of the platforms which we'll be using to promote I&D. So then the second part talks about the norms for faculty and student-driven innovations and you know, startups, like incentivizing students for innovations and entrepreneurship. I told you what sort of incentives the students are going to get. A lot of marks for their work, credit breaks, we talked about it. So for the incentivizing faculties and staff for innovations and entrepreneurships, and there are some norms for the faculty startups also. A lot of norms are reflected in this policy. So these policies, very soon, we are also within 1 week, I'm going to publish this policy on my website. So you can, if you want to read it, you can go to the my NIT website, you'll find this policy. And every institute, every college is now will be having the guidelines have already been given by the MHRD. And then on based upon those guidelines, every institute, every university is developing those policies. So which have mandatory to be put on the websites where the students can go and find out what exactly things are for them in the institutes they belong to. So this is the C part of the policy matter, which is incubation and pre-incubation support. So what type of supports they are getting, you know, so we have to create, institutions have to create pre-incubation, incubation facilities like our labs, our machines, our workshops, the mentors which are available there. If we don't have them, so then the institute will find the nearest incubation center and take their services for the students in the nearest incubation center. Even, you know, the students who are working in NIT, Srinagar, say, for example, if they don't have the facilities available, we can ask IIT Delhi or the nearest IIT Jammu is there, so they can use their facilities to develop their ideas. There will be MOUs which will be signed with them, and then the ministry has already given the guidelines. No, you have to entertain, you have to, you know, get all those startups and the student entrepreneurs on board, and then help them in achieving their objectives. So the policies, so promoting the intensification of technology commercialization, licensing of IPRs, as I told you, from the institute to startup, incubatee and incubation units, provision and streamline relevant services will be given, and mentoring support will be given. So the equity, I told you, it won't cross 2 to 9.5%. And in case of compulsory equity model, startups may be given a cooling period of three, this is very important, three months of cooling period to use the incubation services on rental basis to take final decisions. So there's a cooling period also. So a lot of good things have coming up in these policies. So ownership right, I talked about this ownership right. So even if you have a shares, so it has to be 1 to 4%. You cannot cross more than 4%. So 1 to 2%, and 4% of sales price as a, you know, the technology based in innovations. So as a loyalty, 4% of sales price will go to the institutions, whereas only 1 to 2% if it's a pure software. So these are some of the good things which the startups will enjoy in their respective universities and colleges. And this is, you know, a bird's eye view which I have given you. And I again congratulate the ministry, the policymakers who have given such a wonderful document, wonderful guidelines for the students, not only for the students, but for the faculty and the startups and the entrepreneurs, the innovators, the idea generators of the region. Anyone can come and take advantage of this policy. So thank you so much. I hope that you know, many new things have come in picture, and then I would tell each one of you, the institutes you belong to, you can go to your respective institutes, check whether your management is developing those policies, try to give your inputs as a student, you know, particularly the students who are already working on startups, like Shubham is there. So Shubham can come and give his inputs, what exactly you want, what are the more you know, incentives which you as a student need from the institutes, so you can direct the people, the faculty members who are developing these policies, so that your points are also kept in these policies. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Professor. I mean, it was such a nice, wonderful and insightful session. I mean, we get to know so many things, like how exactly the NIT is doing and how actually the, you know, government is putting their efforts to make these startups grow. Here, one thing I will be saying before I take up the questions, that one thing in common between you, what you said, Professor, and what I also tried to say, the same thing, that we are focusing on two things. One is creativity. One is innovation, design thinking, and thinking out of the box. Well, we are talking about not focusing our students on job seeking, rather we are talking about job creation. We want to talk about these students who are the one of the brightest. You should be think about being a job creator, not the job seeker. Finally, last point, what is the very important thing here, like Professor said, that you want to innovate. There are policies, there are supports from the government. You need to check with your government whether they are saying, like rightly Professor said, whether at least 1% is being spent on the innovation, being spent on R&D, being spent on the startup ecosystem. You can take a much more help. You can get incubated. And like I said in the earlier, that we were missing out somewhere, the Guru Shishya Parampara, we are missing out something we called mentorship. There are a lot of people who are there whom you can get help. You can actually contact all the top entrepreneurs. Even Ratan Tata, you can write a mail and they will be replying back to you for if you need the help being a startup. What you need to do is, like, you need to ask people for the help. So that was there. And I am also hopeful about this new education policy, which is after 34 years, there's a big change happened. And not only if they can implement it, not only the startups will be helpful, but the scenario of the innovation and that scenario of the research and development will be changing forever. India is going to be the youngest by 2023. So India can be the workhorse of the world work engine. So I would like to take up some of this question. So Professor is here, so I will be asking some of the question from the students who have asked here. I can see the Subhanjit. Subhanjit has asked, sir, according to new policy, the undergraduate course will be 3 to 4 years. Then what will be the effect on the course of syllabus? So Professor, can you just help us to understand this? According to the new policy, the undergraduate course will be 3 to 4 years. Then what will be the effect on the course of syllabus? Asking by Shubhanjit.
The syllabus will be taken care. Now, there will be all the syllabus which we had previously, they had to be reframed. When you change the curriculum has to be designed in such a way which will... It's ultimately what you have to understand, the policy means that the curriculum has to be designed in such a way which will enhance the main points which are reflected in the policy. What exactly we want to do, whatever outputs. So in any system, we have inputs, we have value addition, and we have outputs. Now, if I'm changing my policy, so that the outputs are enhanced, they're made better. There's a value addition in a better way. So the curriculum has to be changed. The syllabus has to be changed, but that will be adjusted. I don't know. No, in different streams, it will be adjusted in different ways. Nothing will be missed. Unnecessary things. There are so many things which are unnecessarily, which are being taught. They'll be taken out. Only those things will be taught to students which are of some use, which were exactly, which has an application. That's why, you know, the policy, new policies, whenever new policies come up, there's a change, a paradigm shift in the pedagogy also, in the way things are taught, in the way things are reflected. So unnecessary things which were there, too much of text, too much of cramping, as you rightly said, that has to be removed. And then let's see, you know, it depends upon the subject wise, course wise, stream wise, how exactly those changes are inculcated in such areas.
Yes, Subhasanjit, I just want to add on to this. That thing was like, we need to change the syllabus, of course, and like rightly said, there was something which is actually not needed. If you go to your syllabus only, that you can see there are some stuff which has no use. I know some of the syllabus, being a civil engineer, I'm talking about, there are some of the syllabus which, I mean, some of the elements or the concept is there, or the machineries has been there mentioned in the syllabus, which is no longer usable in the industry. So we need to upgrade. Our focus should be on the industry-oriented focus will be there. Otherwise, the colleges will be running out of students, because see, today, I mean, recently you probably have seen into the news that Google has come up with a new concept, right? They are telling that you don't have to do a conventional education. You don't need to have any degree. You just pay, almost like they are creating their own university kind of a thing for a 6 month or 1 year. You need to just pay to them a certain amount, which is almost like 25% of what you pay to the 4 years of degree. You do it and we will make sure your placement. Not only them, you see the banks, right? Today the banks are also having those sessions. TCS, they are having TCS Ion. All the companies is coming to it. These all industry oriented people, the industries are coming to teach the students. Like, I will be teaching you, learn from me and be my workforce. Right. So if colleges, the education system has to sustain, because everyone will go for this vocational training. Right now, if you see the government approach carefully, what I have shared with you, government approach is very simple. Government want to make sure by the time one person will graduate, they will come up with a skill which can help them to earn money and survive. That's the main focus. Today, let's say a carpenter, if someone wants to be a carpenter, someone wants to be something else, there is no skills for that. They are focusing on the vocational training as well. So call it the education policy is aiming towards that by the time when you will be finishing your, let's say 12th, let's say the your first step of the education, you will be having some skills which can help you to generate money. Or in the direct survival. Right now, that's not there. If you finish 12, there is no job. If you finish 12, you are coming up with only certain things. So that was missing up. So that effect, that will be definitely there into the changes of syllabus. Once they implemented, the first thing they will be doing is probably the changes of syllabus will not be completely removal of the entire thing what you were seeing. But yes, there will be a new addition, and some of the things which will be not helpful, which will be removed. Okay, the next one is, yes. So next one is from Alok Kumar. He's asking, what is the effect of new education policy on us? May we use the multiple entry exit or only for newcomers?
Now,
can they use it?
It depends upon when exactly we are implementing. I think we are implementing it very soon. So,
yes.
Alok, what are you doing? Which position you are presently? You are studying? What are you studying and which semester you are?
So, probably if you are in second or third year, so might be you have a chance to see. But if you are fourth year, we are not sure. Yes.
The policy which I am talking about, your innovation policies of MHRD, we are implementing it very soon. Maybe by next academic year that will be implemented.
Yes.
So the coming academic year we are implementing the policy, so don't worry.
Yes, don't worry. So okay, next question is again from Subhasanjit, that will the course of study will also reduce? It may have adverse effect, as I think. So like I said, it will not reduce, it will be more practical oriented, more skill oriented. And it shall give you the way of earning, that the odd way of employment. That was the main focus. So it is not about the reduction. It is, again, the quantity is not always good. It's all about the quality and what they are giving here. So anyways, I will just take up to a few more questions here. Okay, so Sunil is asking, being a student currently, how can we improve our research and development sector when we are ready or already have initiated a startup? So, professor, so let's say someone like Sohail is asking, he is from Central Institute of Technology, Assam, and he's asking that if the student who has already started a startup or initiated a startup or ready to go hit the market, on that time, how they can improve the R&D, and there again, he's in third year right now. So how he can focus on R&D?
See, you mean to say that R&D pertaining to your startup?
Yes.
Is he talking about the R&D, which is the research and development of his startup activity?
His startup. Yes, his startup activity. Like already he's planning to start, he is in a college. So how he can focus and get benefit probably from the colleges to utilize their resources in the R&D?
Of course, you can. You see, because you have, you know, you see, there are two things now. If you have a startup, startup means an idea. You want to do something. You want to set up an economic unit. You want to earn money. Okay. Now, in that startup, if you have a startup and you want to grow, slowly you want to grow, there's a component of research and development. So you can hire people. You know, you are a startup. That doesn't mean you are working alone. You can have two or three people who can do a good research on your startup. They can help. The research will give you some results that you can easily implement in your startup. So you, on one side, you will be busy with your startup activities, gaining profits, working for the startups, selling your product or services. And on the other side, you will be having your people, your friends, who will be doing some research and development of your product or service or your startup, whatever it is.
So the
institutes will definitely help you. There will be a provision in the policy which you know, you can obtain help in whatever way you like.
Yes. So also, like, you know, sir said that, like, even today professors are also allowed to be a part of to start up. If you're doing something really innovative and you need a great R&D support, you can reach out to your college professors and you can take a direct help. Also, like professor has said that they are talking about spending almost 1% of their whole budget, academic budget, into the, you know, R&D, and government is also focusing on R&D. So you can get that benefit, you know, the benefit of connecting with the professors directly or the students, like such said, like you can add on all those people and can help get the max out of your R&D or initiation.
Mr. Satadru, one thing I'll tell you, when it comes to institute, every institute has an R&D budget. So R&D budget is different. R&D budget is different. And now startup, this is a startup, this is a, you know, entrepreneurship budget, it's different, 1%, as I told you. So these are two different things. Now, the question is, even MHRD is not going to, in the future, they are not going to fund for research, because they said that there's so much of research has been done, and ultimately the research is not culminating into products or the development of technologies. So only those research would be entertained, would be funded by agencies. There'll be research funding agencies. So they will fund only once they are able to, you are able to convince them that there's a research which is being done, and ultimately this research is going to culminate into a innovative idea, a product, and it is going to add value to the economy of the nation. This is very important, because I know there are thousands of research which have been done, and millions of rupees have been spent on those research, and ultimately it's just in the dustbins. You know, those research are not being used anywhere. Maybe a couple of publications in some small journals, and then there's no value addition. There's no value addition of those research. So the times are changing. Even the research and development of when it comes to research in institutions, in universities, the quality has to be increased. So only the quality, a good research, is going to be funded. Normal research will be in times when you will not get funded for any type of research.
Right. The thing was, like, see, Sohail, it's kind of, then the policy is like kind of like how we pitch to a investor. There are every thousand of startups out there, and not everyone get funded. It has to be the right product and right fit. So you will get the main thing was, like, what you can do is, like, you can get connected with your professors, take help of them, and connect with your friends and make a team and ensure that you are in the college. So that's the right time when you have a good opportunity to do a lot of R&D, although you are starting up. So we have another question from Kaushik. He's from Assam Engineering College. Will this new system make students drop out of school right after what's now class 8 and If yes, will they eligible for the jobs? So sir, the professor he's asking is like the with this new system, like the students will be dropping out at class 8, or if yes, then whether they will be eligible for jobs.
I think you mentioned about this thing. Even if you're dropping out, the scope that you can join back.
Right.
Yes. You can join back. Jobs, you know, you can do jobs at any instant of time. Even, you know, it depends upon, you know, suppose there's a student who is financially not very sound. So he doesn't want to continue after 8th. So after 8th, he will take his degree and then do some job, and he can come back when his financial status improves. He can.
Right.
So I think that policy is Sadhguru, you must have gone through it. So can
yes. Yes. The thing was like, like I said, that the first thing was the focus on this. Like I said, that there will be a skilling. So after the drop, first of all, they want to reduce the dropout, right?
Yes.
That is what they make sure. There was a huge student who was like, they were dropping out during the session because of the financial reasons and so many things. So a lot of peep time happened. You know, people don't have money. They have to go for a job and they want to study in future, but they have to start over, which they don't want to. So that was the ultimate focus. So that there won't be any dropouts. And coming to the job perspective, that it right now the situation heading towards something where your degree doesn't count unless or until people want to recruit. Where can you be a part of the money making process? As simple as, are you skillful? If you are skilled enough, you can create a job. If you are skilled enough, you can even start up by your own. So that is not something proportional here directly. So anyways, Sup Sanjeet, you were saying, yes, sir, we should focus on the productive and rather than on the others. Yes. Abhishek Chaudhary, the last question we are taking for the today's session. Sir, we are seeing there a huge technology advancement in education system, but still in the rural areas, there is no better education. So how we will see this education system will enhance, especially in rural India? Hello? Am I audible?
Yes.
So Abhishek is asking how this technological advancement we are seeing in the urban area though, but it's not reaching out to the rural areas earlier. But will this education system will be helpful, or will how it will be enhance the quality of the education in the rural India?
That's a very good question, Yusuf, because now that depends upon the infrastructure availability and the resources which the government pumps in the rural areas is very important. It's very important that, you know, if you want to develop the nation, the rural areas have to be developed. So more infrastructure has to be built up. I know that the budget has increased. There's a lot of enhancement in the budget, which is up now. It has gone from 1.6% to 6%. Am I right, sir?
Yes.
1.6% to
6%. 1.6% was like earlier. And we are planning to hit the 6% of the, ready to give the 6% of the GDP to be invested on the education purpose.
Absolutely. So that if 6% means that new infrastructure will come up, and definitely we'll be having more schools and universities and better education systems, resources available in rural India. So automatically when you have, you know, things in place, you have resources, you have good teachers available, then the quality of education will automatically go up.
See, Abhishek, the thing was like, you can see right now, a lot of students, there are a lot of examinations are still going on in different colleges, okay? So not every student is from the, I don't think they are from the urban area. There are from people who are from rural areas, and for them, they are giving the exams online. They are taking the classes online, because right now COVID has pushed the country towards the technology one way or another. And I mean the way the internet has been introduced in 2016, the cheap rates of the internet, that also helped to the almost 2% India's internet users has been gone up. So the thing was like, technology has slowly coming into the picture, and government, with like Sat said, that government is ready to spend a good amount of the ready for the investment. So that will be definitely helpful to enhance the education overall, not only the urban but for the rural. But yes, it will take a certain time, but definitely the intention here is perfect. What we are seeing. We are seeing the quality of teachers are not good in special ed. So will the system end? Obviously. So here I will just take up this thing that, like, you see right now, the thing was like, we are not limited to some college, some professors, right? Some teachers. Once the technology is there, people have started using the open source platform. There are a lot of videos they can watch in different platforms. Google is there, YouTube is there. They can watch it for free. So that the education has to be gone up. Because after a few days, there will be people, they will be not trusting the quality of the teachers they are having if they are not teaching in the right manner. Today teachers are actually taking it to the next level because they are frontliners. They have to be. If this education policy, you see this education 2020 education policy is a big change. Now, if this big change has to be implemented properly, the frontliners will be the teachers. They will not have the professors, teachers. They are even seeing the COVID situation. They are taking the classes. Before that, they probably haven't even controlled the smartphone as well. We are the people on the 90s or 80s who are born. They have know how to handle the mobile phones. But the professors who were born in the 60s or 70s or 50s, they never even used the smartphone in that way. Now they quickly learned it and adopted the new feature and helping the people. Now, coming to the quality education, which used to be the mugging up, right now professors, teachers are doing also the innovation because when they are going online, they are competing with the entire world. Their limitation is not to their college because students are connected to the entire world and seeing how the teaching being done. So they have to constantly improve and improvising here. So that was the thing. So the quality of the teachers will definitely adding that this thing will be definitely grown up to the next level. I believe that. To Professor, do you want to add something?
I think it's okay. That's the right perspective which you have given them. And then obviously the infrastructure improvement has to be there. Yes. Only once the infrastructure improves and you see the kind of education which is being imparted nowadays because of this COVID, that was a challenging, the emerging challenge which has come up. And there are a lot of lessons which have been learned,
Right.
Maybe there'll be some good insights which will be borrowed and used effectively tomorrow. Right. When things are okay and then we are back to our classrooms. The quality has to be enhanced. Yes. It's very, very important.
Yes.
The quality has to be enhanced. So only once the quality of education is enhanced, the products which we produce, they will be more effective and the value addition will be much better.
Yes. I wish the same thing was like that. So, like I said, so here the main thing was like our frontliners, our professors. I personally believe being I help more than 10,000 students. Currently, I'm responsible for, and currently you people are also learning from me. What I tell always to you people is one simple thing that teaching or the learning, this is a two-way process. I also learn from you. You also learn from me. You teach from you. I teach you. You also teaches me. This is a two-way communication. You have to learn, you have to upgrade your skills. I am a teacher, I have to also learn and have to upgrade myself. This journey will be, probably if someone was not following up, they have to follow, otherwise there will be a question of the survival. That will be there for sure with this new education system. And lastly, Sushanjit is saying, hope that this policy should work, then India is in near future will be counted as one of the finest education system. Yes. Yes, Sushanjit, that's what we also hopeful. We are very hopeful that India will be having the one of the finest education system. A country with 1.2 billion people definitely should have the great education policy and should create more people who can add values, not just create employers. Don't say that it should create only employers or job creators. I don't say should only focus on creating job seekers. I will say that it will help the overall progress, overall growth of an individual and take it to the next level. And that's how our country will shine. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you so much to all of you who have joined and spent with us almost a lovely 2 hours. Thank you, Professor, for such a wonderful session, such a wonderful insight of you. And I'm so happy that way IIED Center in NIT Srinagar and the star is helping the ecosystem or JNK's the startup ecosystem, being a startup founder. I'm so glad. I'm so happy. And I hope this is... this will be really, 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 really so much helpful for all of our students who are listening from the different part of the country. Thank you so much. I'm hopeful to... Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Sabdaru, for giving me an opportunity to interact through your medium to the students. And I hope there was a value addition to the students and they will you know, spread the information, the things which they learned here to their friends and colleagues, and then try to implement what things have been learned here. It's very important. So it's not only learning, but try to envisage and try to implement things at your own level. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you so much, guys. We are hopeful to see you again in our next sessions in somewhere. Thank you so much. Stay safe, stay well, and best wishes for your future. Bye-bye.